Thank you for having me here, and thanks to those of you all who could join today. I'm going to skip all the background science for why this is important, why we need to be teaching our trainees, and just go right into what we're doing now. So I'll talk about these four efforts. The green is the timeline for when we develop these efforts, and then the white is what's under implementation right now. And you can kind of see dating back to really mid to late 2017 is when I started working on climate and health in the curricula for medical education, starting with the pediatrics global health track. And then we'll talk about the elective that I did last spring, as well as the recent paper that came out in academic medicine about integrating climate change into residency education framework. And then we'll talk about what we're doing right now at Emory with our M1 and M2s in their first 2 years, what we call foundations, or that preclinical time set. Next slide, please. So big themes for all of these efforts that I think I've really taken to heart as I've gone through this is start in your realm. I started with pediatrics global health track residents because those are the folks for whom I had some say in what their curriculum was already. I got to design their educational sessions and what they learn. Even if you just have a student with you in your clinical work, you can still start with that student and teach them some way that climate change is affecting the health of your patients or your practice right there in that clinical setting. So start in your realm. Students and residents have been partners in all of these efforts, and there's so much power in that partnership, especially at the School of Medicine level, which was not in my realm. I would not have gone to our deans and said, this is what students need to know. But students came to me and said, can we work on this together? So partnering with students and residents and elevating their voice because they really care about this issue. And then linking to existing structures and topics so that this doesn't feel like it's coming out of left field. For the med student curriculum, we worked really hard to link this to the pathophysiology that's already emphasized in those preclinical years of medicine. For the residency curriculum, we looked at ACGME core competencies and how we can put this into the framework that's already there. And then, of course, through all of this is the value of time, the limited bandwidth that we have, the limited bandwidth that our trainees and students have. And then this question of the curriculum is already so crowded. How do we fit in more topics given that limited time? And the flip side of that is we have limited time to address climate change. So acknowledging the value of time and all of its elements there. Next slide, please. So just to frame, the AMA has said that we should be teaching about climate change at undergraduate, graduate, and continuing medical education levels. This was in 2019. Next slide, please. And so this is the Global Health Track. The Emory Pediatrics Global Health Track was founded in 2011. It's structured so that now we have quarterly half-day sessions with track residents. We typically have about 4 each year, so about 12 to 13 or 14 total. Some years we have 5 residents. And they get those quarterly sessions with us. And then we also do some core curriculum with all of the Emory Pediatrics residents. The Global Health Track residents have mentorship and do scholarly projects with this as well as field rotations. So this is where I really started to think, how can I do this deliberately and help prepare these residents for the challenges that they will face abroad? We know that when we look globally using the disability adjusted life year metric, children are expected to bear 88% of the burden of disease due to climate change. And yet that burden is not equal across countries, with the majority of impact in low-income countries around the world. So I had a faculty development opportunity through something called Emory's Piedmont Project, where I had 2 days of faculty development with people from all across the university, other departments, English theater. We came together for some structured educational time and then had some time to develop this curriculum. So I started with what our Global Health Track resident curriculum already looks like and how I could integrate climate change into that curriculum. So I came up with these 4 domains and really focused on changing patterns of infections, disaster preparedness and healthcare delivery, scarcity of natural resources, and thinking here, malnutrition, food, water scarcity, and then air pollution and respiratory illness. Next slide, please. So these are some examples of the collaborative exercises that I came up with. Because this is a small group, we really have the chance to do hands-on in-depth exercises. So for air quality, we did an ethics jigsaw looking at who contributes to emissions and where those emissions are disproportionately felt. For infections, we looked at our partner sites where residents already have a bi-directional exchange with students from other countries, and we looked at how infectious disease patterns are expected to change over time in those locations in these small group exercises. For disasters, we actually did a field triage out of hospital disaster scenario for the residents where we went through cases and how to triage these based on different findings. And then for natural resources, we looked at the implications of climate change on some of these big questions, food and water availability, and what that may mean for things that we already teach, like global causes of child mortality and food security. We did interactive exercises here that are good with or without climate change, but had an added component, like an Oxfam banquet, where when our residents came in for their quarterly global health track session, we normally feed them lunch and we distributed the lunch based on patterns of nutrition around the world. If this is a great exercise for global health and to kind of start the conversation and thinking about food insecurity and what climate change may do with food insecurity around the world. Next slide, please. So I did an evaluation for this curriculum and asked them questions before we started. How do you think climate issues are relevant to your practice? And got answers like, I think they're relevant, not really sure how. Maybe pollution effects on health, they're just not talked about, they'll become more relevant in the future. To post that climate change will affect the prevalence of all different types of diseases, infectious and otherwise, and will change seasonal patterns of infection, incredibly relevant aspect of our future careers. And they enjoyed the sessions and wanted to keep them for future residents. Next slide, please. When they self-assess their climate and health knowledge before these sessions, none of the residents had ever had any prior climate and health training. Now this is changing, right? Because now we're starting to do this in medical schools, but this was back in 2018 and none of these residents had had prior climate and health training. They mostly did not feel comfortable with their own knowledge about climate risk, adapting their differential, being able to identify resources, being able to identify how to care for a child in a global disaster scenario or to triage in a disaster. Post these sessions, they did feel like their own knowledge had increased. Next slide, please. And so this is an example of some of the slides that we would use along with the more experiential hands-on learning exercises. So in global health, this is a chart that we look at that shows the causes of child mortality around the world divided by cause. And we talked through this, and even this one slide could be the topic of conversation for more than an hour of lecture. But we looked at all of these causes of global child mortality and said, what do you think climate change, how does climate change fit in with these? Does climate change matter for these causes of mortality? Can you go forward for me? I mean, this is just part of the picture that started looking at the implications of extreme heat on preterm birth. That whole yellow slice of the pie is those neonatal deaths, those first 28 days of life, where anything that causes a child to be born earlier has an enormous impact. And we're starting to know more and more about the implications of heat and pollution on premature birth. And we looked at poor air quality, vector-borne diseases and extreme weather events, and all of these overlap. So this is just starting to tease apart the puzzle, but was the subject of conversation for one of those lectures. Go forward for me. And then of course, malnutrition contributes to about half of all under five mortality around the world. So we talked about climate as it relates to malnutrition. Next slide, please. But to avoid talking about just the mortality side and the negative impact side, we talked about the Eat Lancet framework for a diet, a global diet that's within human health bounds and planetary health bounds, and talked about the enormous power of changes in diets to actually reduce carbon emissions and be part of the solution, but challenges that come with that and when you think about the global perspective. And this is all in that same session where we do the Oxfam banquet as well. So we're looking at food security, health equity, climate impacts, and have some experiential learning there too. Next slide, please. And so this is from this year, kind of fast forward. I just gave some examples of what we're doing there with the Global Health Track, but the really exciting thing is then the residents start to own this material and move forward with it where they will. So every year we do a Global Health Week, and this year the residents chose the theme, food security and child nutrition, food for thought. And our keynote lecture that they wanted to invite was Nathaniel Uchtman, who spoke about healthy children, healthy food, healthy planet, planting seeds of stewardship for a just and sustainable future. So they're now choosing to incorporate this into their own curriculum. This is an event that includes faculty from across Emory and Children's Pediatric Institute. And then they spearheaded their own food waste challenge for fellow residents and for faculty during that week, which is that middle picture there, is one of my residents, Vanessa Ford, day one of the food challenge, looking at getting rid of leftovers in the fridge and educating colleagues about how much food we throw away and what the implications of food waste are on climate change. You can see there on the far right picture, they did a survey of those who participated in the food waste challenge, just having people to be aware of their own food waste. And this is really powerful because it's coming from the residents now. This is no longer us teaching in a classroom, it's them having owned this material and moving forward with it and being aware of it in their own lives and in their own careers. For three of the residents, they're also working on a scholarly project for their scholarly project component of the Global Health Track that has something to do with climate change. So an example would be one of the residents has worked with me on a survey of pediatric practices in the state of Georgia and climate readiness for the challenges that we are likely to face in Georgia. It's just one example there. Next slide. So that kind of sums up the Pediatric Global Health Track resident, what we've done over the past 3 years. And those are the residents with whom I have the most in-depth interaction and the most opportunity for interaction. Couldn't do justice to all that we've done, but hopefully that overview is helpful. The next thing I wanted to talk about is this N3 and N4 elective, the third and fourth year med student electives that took place last spring. And this is almost the opposite, a counterpoint to the Global Health Track curriculum, which was designed very deliberately. This was done really quickly. Basically, our students were pulled off of their clinical rotations because of coronavirus. They couldn't be in those clinical settings. They needed electives during that time, and the schools were looking for faculty to create these electives. So this happened really quickly. But because we were entering this virtual world, there was an opportunity to bring in climate experts from around the country in this virtual platform. And that's how this happened. So really the green of development should extend throughout because we were kind of building this while we were flying it. But the actual elective took place last April. Next slide, please. And so that QRS code will get you right to the elective. It's all of the lectures have been archived on Emory's Office of Sustainability Initiatives website there for us. This just shows what that looks like. There with the first lecture was Climate 101, What Every Clinician Needs to Know by Dr. Ari Bernstein at Harvard. And this elective was meant to be clinical practice oriented. So the climate crisis as it matters for clinical practice. For these third year students on the cusp of their rotations, the way Emory's curriculum works, they would have just been starting their third year rotations when they were pulled off from the pandemic, and those fourth years who had just finished their third years and were getting ready to move forward. Next slide, please. And so for this virtual lecture series, I broke it down into major themes for each week, and Perry Sheffield at Mount Sinai really helped me brainstorm these ideas and help identify lecturers who could come, and the Mount Sinai students actually did this simultaneously with the Emory students that week under her guidance for their local small group activities. So the major themes are climate change and emerging challenges, health equity and social justice, natural disasters, climate impacts and solutions for the healthcare sector, and climate communication. In truth, these all kind of blended a little bit week to week because we were depending on lecturers' availability to come do this kind of spur of the moment and lend their time so generously. And the overwhelming positive response from the lecturers that I invited was just incredible, that people were willing to do this with such short notice for our students. There ended up being 17 lectures, just an amazing panel of guest lectures. These are all done live, and the students participated in moderating the Q&A for each session. The recordings are made available. And because of the virtual platform, we were bringing in lectures from around the country. We opened it up to students from around the country. All students that registered couldn't attend each lecture because of their own classes back at their home institution, but about 230 folks registered for these sessions, which was just amazing and shows up a pent up a demand for this from our students. Some schools were able to use these lectures for their own electives at their home institution using the recordings. And then the Mount Sinai and Emory students did this kind of live as an elective during. And there were over 30 institutions represented in all of those registrants. And yeah, the recordings are available for the public. Brittany, if you wanna go back a slide, that QRS code, it will bring you right to that website where those are. If you're able to snap that on your phone, just hold your phone up and flash it. It'll bring you right to those lectures. Thank you for that question. And I can send out the link at the end as well. All right, next slide. So in addition to the virtual lectures that were available for everyone, we did small group talks with just the Emory students. And these are some of the topics for those that kind of paralleled what I already had done with the global health students. So we talked about adapting your differential diagnosis to a changing climate, being prepared for emerging conditions that we will see more frequently because of climate change. We talked about climate change and ethics in medicine, disasters and resilient healthcare. And we did some hands-on sessions speaking climate to patients, how to talk about climate change in the exam room setting, both sick and well visits. And then we did small group exercises where the students were the teachers and they gave their presentations. Up in the student projects at UC, they did climate by systems talks. So by systems, meaning like pulmonary, cardiology. So the student signed up for something that they wanted to do. Because they're at a time where they're kind of differentiating into their careers, what they're thinking of, it was fine if two chose the same topic. We had a couple people choose infectious diseases and that was fine, but there's so much to cover in these small chalk talks that I wanted this to be something they were really passionate about and could talk to their fellow students about. And the amazing thing about these chalk talks that the students did is that they've been taking them onto their third and fourth year rotations when they're on the wards and they're tasked with talking to their small team, their wards team, about any subject. Some of my students have presented on climate change, building off the chalk talks that they did for this elective. So there's starting to be these tendrils that are running through where they're kind of spreading the word on wards in clinical settings to other groups too. And then all of the students did a final project. Some actually did more than one, but these were the topics and I let them come up with their own topic through talking with me if they wanted to. But they looked at heat sensitive medications tables and made a list of those, how this would affect their prescribing practices. Some students created patient resources for environmental determinants of health. So an example would be like a reasonable accommodation letter for a mother who is pregnant and working outside, looking at the medical legal interface and how we can support patients for harms that they may experience because of climate change, like mold and mildew exposure in the home is another one. The idea was that then these could be linked into the medical record and have actual clinical use if we're able to share them with clinicians in our primary care clinics. And then some students did recommendations looking at Emory has a really robust sustainability plan and they took a look at the healthcare side and said, is there anything that you would change or add here? What are some opportunities, maybe even to use students in the sustainability plan that we could implement? All of the students did a 55 word reflection at the end as well. Next slide. So this is an example of some of the slides that were part of those small group exercises for the Emory students. And I put this slide in here, which seems perhaps a little bit out of space, just to emphasize that we had really rich discussions in the small groups, and that was really valuable. We were able to talk about things from a broader perspective, looking at a little bit history of medicine, expanding out to this more planetary health scope, really thinking about the relationship between nature and medicine over time as we talked about things like the seasonality of infectious diseases. So what this slide is showing is down in Apalachicola, Florida. There's a museum to Dr. John Gorey, who's one of the pioneers of the air conditioning. And he went down to fight a yellow fever epidemic back in the 19th century. And he had said nature would have terminated the fevers by the changing of the seasons, which led him to try and invent a way to keep a room cooler than the outside air. And it was just a fascinating example of this longstanding relationship between medicine and observations of nature, which is our longest running experiment. So this is kind of some of the discussions we were able to tease out in these small group sessions. Next slide. And then other of the small group sessions were incredibly practical and exactly what we need to be talking about in clinic. So we did case-based topics. This one was a sports physical for a high school athlete in the summer. This is something I worry about a lot this year when a lot of our kids are going to be a little bit deconditioned from having not done sports for a while, when they get out there and their incredible August hot summer heat and their football pads. What are we doing to prepare them and to prevent heat-related illness in our high school athletes? So this is a sports physical for a high school athlete. They talked about these in small group sessions, and then we came back together and talked about the cases together. And I gave them talking points as well as some resources to look at real differences that advocacy has made in this realm, that like states that have mandated heat guidelines for high school athletes actually have less heat-related illness, to think about the bigger picture as well as the clinical setting. Next slide, please. And then I didn't want this to just be about sick visits and climate impacts. I want to talk about how we protect patients from ever feeling those as well, and talk about well visits. So we went through some of the Bright Futures guidelines, which is what we use in pediatrics for well visits. I'm a primary care pediatrician, and some of the guidance that we're already supposed to be giving, and talked about synergies between just routine guidance in a primary care setting, thinking about those environmental determinants of health and health promotion, and how we can talk about climate change and well visits too, what the opportunities are there. Next slide, please. And so these are some of the student reflections, and these are from Emmeline Laney and Benjamin Rabin, and they're just beautiful. I'll read them out for you. So Emmeline said, this is the 55 word reflections that all the Emory students did at the end of the course. So Emmeline says, the augmenter of all things unequal. It begins the moment you're not but 200 cells, but you're strong. Who knew it permeated the air you breathe, the water you drink, the food you eat, the school you learn in, but you are resilient. Yet you see, you shouldn't have to be anything other than you. And Ben says, how has climate change imprinted on our consciousness? Emaciated bears clinging to a solitary ice slope, dumpsters drifting through flooded boulevards, family odysseys through Aegean islands to makeshift cities, urate crystals on microscopy, silica transported across alveoli, a groundswell, not of water, but of doctors, patients, and those who care for justice in a livable planet. And all of the students together, these just make a beautiful compilation of some of their reflections on this course. And I think it also starts to give our trainees a way to process this existential crisis that we have. There's a real link between their practice of medicine, concern about the world in which they live, and not always having the time, especially for those who are really passionate, to be addressing what they think is the biggest health crisis of our time. And so there's a link to wellness here, to reducing their burnout, and to giving us and our students space to reflect and process the challenges that we face. And the students at the top, you'll see their Twitter handle at Emory MSCA. They, after this elective, banded together and formed a student group, and they have over 40 members now. They've continued to work with me on incorporating climate change into their curriculum. We'll talk more about Emmeline and Ben and how we've been working together over the past few years now as we move forward. But I wanted to highlight their beautiful reflections. Next slide, please. And so the residency education framework we'll talk about next. It took a lot, it's very in depth. This is a publication that came together. It took a really long time to get it all together. And it was published online last September and just published in print this past month. So it's all out there now. Next slide, please. This is the online version that was published in September. You can do the same thing with that QRS code and link directly to the article in Academic Medicine. This is the first curriculum on climate and health education for residency trainees that we could find, kind of published in the literature. Next slide, please. I had an amazing group of collaborators, just such a pleasure to work with all of these individuals. And Perry Sheffield and Ari Bernstein and I kind of brought the climate perspective, and then Andrew White, Amanda Asta, and Marcia Anderson really brought the education perspective. So it was a collaboration between climate folks and education folks, looking not just what we thought warranted coverage in the curriculum, but how could it actually happen? How could we support those program directors who were looking to heed that AMA call and who wanted to implement this into their curriculum, but weren't sure how to do so? You can see the in-print version there with that beautiful cover that just came out this month. Next slide, please. And I wanted to just take a moment to acknowledge that while we started working on this in 2018 and couldn't find any examples, people have been calling for this for a while. They have been saying, we really need to be teaching our trainees and med students about the challenges that they're going to see in their practice. We need to prepare them for what they will face. That's part of our role as faculty. So in November of 2007, the AAP policy statement on global climate change and children's health said, we need to work to ensure that concepts related to pediatric health implications of climate change are part of the pediatric training and curricula. That was 2007, and we're just now really building momentum in this area. Next slide, please. And so what are paper did? It's a curricular framework. We linked, again, back to what residents are already supposed to learn and what program directors are already held accountable for, these ACGME core competencies. And we detailed how climate change harms health. Next slide. How it requires adaptation in our clinical practice, the way that we need to be preparing our patients and working with them. And these are some examples of heat action plans or disaster preparedness checklists for patients. Next slide, please. And how climate change disrupts our healthcare delivery. These are really prominent examples. NYU Hospital during Hurricane Sandy that required evacuation, shortages of medical supplies during or after Hurricane Maria in Puerto Rico, and then evacuation routes during Hurricane Irma, where even if our facility is not in the direct path of a disaster, we're going to be faced with absorbing so-called climate migrants, or these regionally displaced people from climate scenarios from surrounding areas, and need to be able to care for people away from their medical home and make sure that our healthcare system can absorb those displaced individuals. Next slide, please. And so I'm not going to go through that whole article now, because now I feel like it's packaged, it's there, it's available to for all of you to read about if you'd like to, but this is what the structure looks like in the appendix, where we identify learning objectives. We link it to the ACGME core competencies. So MK is medical knowledge, PC is patient care, and we go through all of the core competencies. We list these objectives as core, something really every resident should know, or advanced, where just those who may have a particular interest want to go on and learn more about. And then we give learning formats for program directors to use, ways that they can implement these. And that will depend on the local setting. Every residency program is structured differently. So there's going to have to be a variety of options that can be suited to that local context. And then we give assessment strategies, and then we have curricular points and notes, which really go through these topics and how we hope that they can be integrated into the curriculum. We presented this on the Association of Pediatric Program Directors virtual cafe last December, and started hearing about different ways that program directors are thinking about how they can include this content. And it really does depend on the place. I think this is a great start. It's not enough. Program directors still need more resources, and we call for that in the paper, saying this is a framework, maybe as a next step, We can think of if American Board of Pediatrics or APPD or AAP can put together a toolkit for program directors and thinking of the other specialties as well, internal medicine, family medicine, to really accelerate the integration of this content. That really would be a great next step, but it gives people a place to start who are looking to do this already without delay. Next slide, please. All right, and then for the first and second year med students, what we're doing is the last thing I'm gonna cover. Next slide, please. And this is where Ben and Emily are co-first authors of this piece that came out this past October. Again, one of the first, if not the first, examples of a curriculum for medical students in those first 2 years. On climate change and education linked to pathophysiology. Next slide, please. And so this curriculum has been possible because of students, and I can't emphasize that enough. Students were looking for a mentor in this space. They came and asked me if I would serve in that capacity, but they're the ones who have the ability to advocate for what they want to see included in the curriculum at the School of Medicine level in a way that I would have not had the ability to do. So this is their timeline in 2019. I met them before February, but February we really decided we're going to do this. Through that spring, they held some climate and health interdisciplinary events for students, more like the lunchtime talk, just gauging interest at the school. In May and June, they brainstormed and outlined a curriculum proposal. We met, looked over it, edited it as they're meeting with senior faculty members to kind of see, is this possible? What shape could this take? Because they were still living through the curriculum, they were able to say, climate change really is not mentioned. I think it ended up being mentioned once in their first and second years of med school. And they were also able to see, but this is places where it would fit in the curriculum so well. So they did this real-time identification of opportunity for this content across the M1 and M2 years while they were sitting in class learning. They presented to the student curriculum committee, then we presented together to the faculty curriculum committee, and then this was presented for us for the executive curriculum committee and was ultimately endorsed by the Emory administration that we can move forward with implementing this curriculum. So in July of 2019, we were already able, just by virtue of their initiative, to get one lecture, an overview of climate and health in prologue, those first 2 weeks of med school for all of the M1s. And we were able to start that then, even while we were working on getting approval to move forward with implementation of the rest of the curriculum, which is what we're doing now for the group that started last July, is getting this in a disseminated fashion throughout their first and second year pathophysiology modules. Next slide. And so this is from the paper. This is an example of what some of these topics look like, some of the learning objectives that we started with. These are all being kind of revised as we implement. But the overall concept here is we wanted to give students context for these topics. We know that there is far too much in every realm of medicine to teach it all. But without even having the backbone for climate and health to attach these topics to, we felt like there was a missed opportunity for students that we really were not preparing them to be lifelong learners in this realm. So rather than asking for a lot of time in the curriculum, we asked for a little bit of time in a lot of different places to contextualize this effort. Next slide, please. So Emmeline and Ben started with me when they were M1s, and now they are M3s, and they have just done an enormous effort in advocating for this. They also talk to, on their M3 years, they give talk talks on climate and health to faculty. They've been talking about this. They've been invited to give radiology grand rounds at Emory in a couple weeks. So they are really taking this forward and moving it forward on their own in a way that's so much more powerful than what I could do. But my biggest anxiety is they're M3s, so how do we ensure the sustainability of a curriculum when our students get towards their graduation so much faster than it seems like they should? So move forward. This year, we added on a crew of M1s to help us with implementation of the curriculum, and now we're all working together. And I think that's a huge component of partnership with students, is to think about the sustainability plan and kind of knowledge management, all of this knowledge that we've worked on together and that we have as a group. How do we ensure that it doesn't leave with the students when they graduate, and that we're able to keep that link to the student voice, which is so powerful? Next slide, please. So kind of talk through the big timeline to get approval to implement, but how does the implementation actually work? The truth is, we know that this effort is entirely dependent on the will of the module directors and the individual lecturers that we speak with. We have no sticks and really no carrots other than just goodwill. So what we've done is we've met with the foundation's director a few times. That's the person that oversees this preclinical curriculum. He has linked us up with the module directors. So on a rolling basis, he will introduce us to the module directors. Then we've met with them. We've talked about what we envisioned including in their module and then asked for their input. What do you see would be valuable in what you're teaching about? Where does this fit in with the learning objectives that you already are tasked with covering? Make sure that we hear their concerns and identify lectures that would be good fits for this content. Then we meet with the individual lecturers. Most often we have actually met, so we'll have a 30 minute to an hour meeting with the individual lecturers. A couple have been like, yes, this is great, I wanna do this, and it's just been over email. But for the most part, we've met with them. And those have been really great conversations to hear questions of the lecturers, hear their thoughts for how this could work and what some of them lecture about year after year after year, how this could work in that content for students, where they see points of confusion or points of opportunity. And then we ask what they would want in their ideal world for support. Some folks just want references, citations for them to go look at and incorporate the content. Several have asked us to create slides, which we have done, and said, here are some possible slides that this could fit in with what you've done. Sometimes it's a matter of adding a bullet point to a lecture where everything is already perfectly set up to talk about climate health and maybe pollution, but just adding that bullet point. And then we incorporate their feedback, they present, and it becomes kind of an ongoing process there. The kind of main takeaways there are tailoring it to each lecture and then being sensitive to their, some of them have already been asked to cut out a lot of content. So being sensitive to time, again, is that big question of time. Next slide, please. This has gone better than I thought it would. There's not been a lot of pushback. And in fact, there's been a little bit of a snowball effect where by going through this process, by going through each stage of the curriculum approval process, by meeting with each module director and each lecturer, people are thinking about climate change a little bit more collectively in a way that they perhaps hadn't before, and how this may matter for their practice or even how this could matter for their research interests going forward, which has been really exciting to see. We have really emphasized partnerships, this co-creation of knowledge framework, having support from leadership faculty as well. We have really emphasized our own flexibility to be able to work with lecturers, because if they don't want to teach it, it's just not going to work. So it has to work within the context of their lecture. We've recognized that space is tight. So as a part of our initial proposal to the faculty curriculum committee, Ben and Emmeline went through and calculated the total lecture time and the amount of lecture time that this would take to present it as a teeny fraction of what's taught overall. This really is not asking for a lot of it. And then we've prioritized those areas for which the climate and health evidence base is the strongest right now, knowing that that will evolve with time. For these 2 years, we focus on the pathophysiology that students are supposed to be learning anyway, and linked it right to that existing framework. And then we've had real partnership with our faculty in social medicine and social justice curriculum as well. Next slide. So this is just an example. We just finished pulmonology. So this is some of those touch points with students. They have a small group lecture on pulmonary function tests. So we added a pediatric case on environmental determinants of health, looking at redlining and racial justice and the implication of pollution for a child's pulmonary function tests to fit right there in with that small group that they were already doing, but from a different angle that had not been represented in the curriculum before. Just the immense implications of pollution as it relates to climate change on child development. In the lectures, we had content in three lectures: asthma, pediatric respiratory disease, and COPD. And those are some of the topics there. In the COPD lecture, for example, things came up that I actually hadn't thought about before, how particle size is hugely important for things like drug development and drug delivery and pulmonology. So this, by talking to each lecture, we're really able to get their perspective and see how this may work with what they teach in a way that we just hadn't considered. Our goals for next year for the POM module, I had a feedback session with the module director earlier this week, and we hope to add test questions for students and do a more thorough evaluation for this content. Next slide, please. And so those are the four areas where I've been working at Emory, always with students and trainees. And I think big picture takeaways and exciting takeaways are we're gonna have to adapt as we go, because our students hopefully will come in with more of a knowledge on climate and health impacts, and we'll have more, especially in residency, from what they've already learned in med school. So we get to advance this content a little bit as we go. The co-creation framework with both students, residents, and the other faculty who will be teaching this is hugely important and powerful. The process is important to build momentum and can have that snowball effect. I don't think it's enough to just take slides and give them to people. That process is really important. And then I have not done a great job at evaluating this. It's something that I'd love to do more of in the future. And I think there's so much more we could do if we had more time. Time is the limiting factor here. Our time in the curriculum, and again, this race against the clock time-wise for climate change. But on the flip side, go forward for me. We have, go back one. Getting back to the scout, we have the momentum is building. It's undeniably building for this space, and there's a necessity that's also undeniable. A necessity and in some ways an inevitability. Next slide. And so just a note on synergies, I think there are lots of places in academic medicine, even in the third and fourth years of med school, in our own lives as faculty, where these efforts can really work together, where there you may find kindred spirits in other faculty. One, of course, is sustainability initiatives across the healthcare setting. This is ripe for quality improvement type projects for third and fourth year students. And it also touches on wellness, avoiding burnout in faculty. I think there's a lot of linkages there. Social medicine and racial justice, what we call at Emory, the community learning and social medicine curriculum. They've been partners in this and interested in implementing this and what they do as well. The patient quality and safety folks, including quality improvement initiatives, again, a great opportunity for students. Our antibiotic stewardship director at CHOA is one of my partners in crime for the CHOA sustainability initiatives, and there's a lot of synergy there as it relates to climate change. Any existing research effort that may have an environmental health component, I think it's easier to add climate to an existing research effort than start an entire new effort. And some folks may be interested in doing that. And then of course, PEDS and global health. So where I started in global health, there's an incredible need around this notion of climate migration and the broad movements of individuals at home, as well as synergies with some of the global health activities abroad. Then of course, state professional societies and advocacy, like with AAP, like with ACOG, there's already efforts underway where we can connect students and build momentum. Next slide.